Hey, what's up, everyone? This is Jeremy Fondo of QuickMail.io.
Hey, and this is Jack from EmailsThatSell.com.
Today, tear down.
Tear downs. Okay, Jeremy, let's kick things off with a cold email that landed in your inbox. Inbox, right? Not spam folder?
Yeah, inbox. That's correct. Usually every time I got an email that is cold email I'm not interested in, I just put it usually into the cold email folder, swap file,
yep,
you name it. And this one, we got it. It's called co-promotion opportunity. Do you want to read it?
Yep. Okay, so 1 point already awarded for landing in the inbox. Let's see how the body follows. Hi, Jeremy. I head up the content marketing for blank, a tool that helps over 250,000 professionals improve their email productivity. I'm reaching out to see if you'd be interested in working together on some co-promotion. I came across this article, hyperlinked, on your blog, and would love to get some content of ours included to the piece. In return, I'd be more than happy to link back to your content on the multiple blogs I have access to, as well as promoting on social. Interested? Cheers.
Well, typical, backlink building strategy, reaching out to other people who got a blog and say, hey, would you like to exchange a link, I give you one link, you give me mine, we
right.
give me one, and then we do a transactional kind of.
So as the recipient, did you read it?
Oh, that's a good question. Definitely not entirely, but I actually will give them points for that. Not that I didn't read it, but that they've been very explicit in their subject line. Say co-promotion opportunity.
True.
That's great. I read it. I say not in that space right now. Read the first line, feel, yeah, that's not what I want, and put it into my swap file folder.
Yeah. Okay. So I'll go ahead and mention something about the intro. The intro, if you recall, mentions the job title, content marketing for a particular company, and that this tool helps over 250,000 professionals. But I feel like that sort of buries the lead. Sure, it's a good credibility indicator that they've got a big user base. But the main point here is that they want to help promote QuickMail on sites. They want to improve the blog posts that you have on your website.
Yeah, and I think it's just too soon. They are going into trying to prove their credibility, but I'm not quite sure what they offer yet.
They're missing the hook. They didn't get your attention before they dove in. So I'm going to ding them, even though that is a really strong statement. It's a good position to have 250,000 users, but change the order a little bit.
That's right. I would also, yes, that's right. I would put it toward the end where I'm like questioning in my mind, you know, are they really legit or stuff like that? Sounds interesting. Mm-hmm. And then goes to different questions in my mind, like are they credible and stuff like that? Then
sure.
That comes right. The other thing I would say is, and that may be more my critical analytic mind, is like it's a vanity metric. Maybe out of the 250,000 professionals, maybe three of them are still using their service.
Or, you know, or two of them are paying.
Two are paying. That's right. So it's a little bit of credibility would go a long way if there is more results oriented rather than vanity oriented.
Here's an idea I had. Instead of saying we have 250,000 users, which doesn't really correlate to helping your blog get more traffic, instead, you could say something like, since we have over 250,000 users, there's a good chance that anything we promote on our site will get good traffic back to QuickMail.
That's right. Or even like, you know, usually people we work with just see a spike of 10%, 20% in traffic, then that's done, you know, job done.
Right.
The other thing is that they also use my first name as personalization, which is good. You know, it's kind of the thing that you kind of have to have now. You can't really do it without it. One extra step would be great as well to mention, like, since you're in the cold email space, or the 20% extra from people in also cold email space. So, you know, some sort of relevancy, because if that extra traffic is coming from people who are foodies, for example, then what does that have to do with my website, right?
Exactly.
So a little bit more targeting will be really nice. But again, like we just said, too soon for this line.
Okay, so what's next in this email?
Well, what's next is they mentioned that they came across an article on my website. Now, I didn't click on that link for two reasons. The first one is I think it's irrelevant since pretty much all my blogs are about the same topic. So whether they choose like, I came across, you know, your advice on following up or your advice on how to send a cold email, it doesn't really matter. At the end of the day, they're all kind of the same topic. So I didn't click on that because of this. But the second reason why I didn't click on it is because they also have a tracking link. It's actually not a proper link to my website. It's a tracking link. And I just frown upon this, especially on the initial email when we're trying to build trust. It's like, are you really trying to track me at that first email, the first relationship we're going to have? I kind of frown upon that. I distaste it. It shows that it's not really genuinely trying to connect with me, but it's actually trying to get a good monitoring on their stats.
Yeah.
And it's a typical, classical, even I would say, example of watching an experiment is actually detrimental to yourself. It's the same thing with including an open tracking link, you know, with the image, you're going to get less deliverability. Mm-hmm. If you include tracking in your links, you're going to get less deliverability and people will not be willing to click on it because they will feel like, okay, I'm getting spied on, right? Mm-hmm. So definitely avoid doing that. It's an example of getting your stats on metrics is actually going to get you away, you know, clients and potential replies in the future. Really bad deal. Yeah.
Okay, so what if they had mentioned this article link, but didn't use any tracking?
I would have clicked on it, check if it would be relevant to the conversation as well.
Okay.
Like I mentioned, I don't think it would have been. So I'm not even like curious enough to even click on the tracking to figure out what link they actually mean.
Sure.
But if they say things like, hey, come across this article, I will strongly agree with this point, but this point here I would disagree with.
Right.
And I'd love to have a conversation maybe in the future. Then it's like, oh yeah, that's interesting. That's, there is a real conversation, a real attempt to connect.
Sure.
But if it's just like a random link on Maya, it's like, hey, I watch a blog, I watch an article on your blog. Then don't even put a link. Just say you just watch an article, read an article on my blog.
It's also using reciprocity. If they've shown that they read your article and put a thoughtful comment, you sort of owe them one to at least consider what they're about to ask, right?
Absolutely. Okay. Like, you know, 200% on that one.
Okay. So there's two more lines here in the email. I'll recap it for our listeners. It says, in return, I'd be more than happy to link back to your content on the multiple blogs I have access to, as well as promoting on social. Interested?
Yeah, so in this case, I would say it's a shame that my value come at the end. Mm. You know, until there, they basically like broke their contract of their email subject. So the subject line say co-promotion opportunity. Co-promotion to me in my mind means like we're both benefiting from something.
Mm.
And it's a shame that we have to come to the actual end of the email, the kind of like last line before the call to action, to just say, you're going to see value out of that. All the other one is them trying to sell themselves on what they want. Mm-hmm. And at the end, as a sort of like afterthought, they say in return, you know, we'll be happy to do something for you. And what I really ding them on is that they went to link one of my article, but they don't actually tell me on what domain they will put my stuff. So I can't even like go and check it. If instead they had reversed it and say, hey, we read some of your articles on your website, we think it'd be like great for audience. Here's a few links to some of those domains that we could get you on. And then those ones will be tracked. But at that stage, I'd be curious enough to still click on it.
Sure.
Right. But here they sort of like got it reversed. Mm-hmm. And I don't think that lands very well.
They could even say, by the way, the sites that we're interested in linking back to, here's the traffic stats for last month.
That'd be awesome.
Be even way better. So it seems like there's some real value here. It's just buried under selfish lines of this cold email until the very bottom, when you may have not even read it because we're going to take a glance at an email, figure out if it's worth taking a second glance and going on from there.
Yeah, that's right. And I would add on top of that, that there is real value, but since there's so many people offering the same product, you're going to have to show a bit more. And I have zero doubt that this sort of tactic and approach and strategy works super well. But people will have to do a little bit of homework first before being willing to reply to you. So if you help them out by really showing them that you're serious, this is some of the results and we really want your domain, you know, and then we're willing to put so much effort into it, then that's fine. I think you're going to get the thing. So there's nothing wrong with a proposition per se. I would even be in a space to be willing to go that way. Actually, in fact, I did that with someone else that managed to prove, you know, more value than those guys.
By basically showing they did their homework, they fact-checked.
It was the other way around, actually. I did contact them because I would have loved Quickmail to be listed into one of those pages.
Right.
And so we had the conversation about that and he was more than happy to do it at the end. But in this case, there was you know, a clear exchange of value on the both ends. That's lacking here. So I'm not going to spend the effort pursuing because it obviously didn't spend any efforts doing it. So what are the chances that the value they're going to deliver are going to be great enough or going the extra mile with me? If I have a problem with them, will they consider me like this cold email or will they actually go a bit further? There's just too much offering in the space to be able to be lazy.
So we've covered a lot of points here, but a couple things I'm taking with me is you need to earn your prospect's attention first before you can think about launching into your credibility pitch or anything else. And next, if you've got some incredible stats that show that you're a legitimate company, such as 250,000 users, try and flip that stat around so it's really obvious how you can help your prospects. So in this case, it would have been, we typically get 100,000 monthly visitors to our site, should be good traffic since they're all in the email space for Quickmail. You know, that's A plus, this email, not quite there.
Yeah, and one more thing I will throw in the mix is that this is super relevant for every service industry. So if you're listening to us and you're offering like SEO or any type of marketing thing that a lot of other people are providing, just have a think about like how can you demonstrate real tangible value for your user. It's not that they don't want it. Most people need SEO. Most people need, you know, marketing. Most people need XYZ. It's more of a trust game, relationship building. And if you're too lazy to do your research, then you're going to get on
Someone else is going to get that prospect.
Or you're going to get the wrong customers, right? The one who are like a pain in lots of parts of your body to deal with.
Sure. All right. It's time to look at the follow-up sent by the same sender. Here it goes. Same subject line. Hey, quick follow-up from my email last week in relation to working together on some co-promotion. Let me know if you're interested, Jeremy. Thanks again. Signature.
Yeah.
I'll say it.
Okay.
Okay. Weak call to action. Let me know if you're interested. That's, I think 99% of call to action should have a question mark. Otherwise, it's in very risky territory for being a passive call to action, which is easy to ignore and gets ignored a whole lot of the time. So that's sort of screaming at me. Jeremy, what do you got?
Well, typical classical bump email. It's kind of funny. They experimented with putting my customization name in the body instead of just hi.
That's true.
But honestly, there's nothing really remarkable about it. As soon as I read it, I put it into my swap folder and then off we go.
What could they have put here that may have swayed you?
Simple. And it's a great question, but simple. They could simply say like, hey, since I sent you the last email, I've done a little bit more research. And blah.
Mm-hmm.
And that's cool because then, you know, people assume rightly or wrongly that if time passes, if they have done some extra things in between, then it's worth communicating those extra things. So, hey, since last week, you know, I've been doing XYZ or ideally that'll be about me.
Yeah.
Because most people will say like, hey, since last week, you know, we closed 20 other people. It's like, great. But what about me?
Yeah.
So again, it's if they would have flipped it, talk about me, my benefits.
Right.
You know, what would be better now to reply than it was last week? Up for it. But typical bump email, nothing else than, you know,
your name and the body of the email.
That's it.
All right. Good points. We've got another cold email to tear down for you guys. I'm going to go ahead and tackle the subject line. It is basically the name of the company sending the email, which is Aluma. And then and a letter X and a merge tag for the company they're reaching out to. So that would be like emails that sell X Quickmail. Okay. So confusing as that may be, here's the body of the email. Hi, first name. Hope you don't mind me reaching out. Exclamation point. I was hoping to connect because we've helped similar online communities, parentheses, Redbubble, cut the time and cost associated with extracting data, transforming it, and loading it into your data warehouse all in real time. I would love, all in caps, love, to start a conversation with company to share how we are helping these companies understand what challenges you may be experiencing with your current ETL solution and see if we can be helpful. What will your thoughts be on a purely exploratory call to determine if Aluma can add value? Thanks. Whew. Okay. right off the bat, this is a pretty technical email, and I hope they are sending it to a pretty technical person. Otherwise, jargon goes over our heads. Our brain sort of shuts down. We click the delete button and carry on.
Yeah, fair point.
Okay, from the top, tell us what you think of the first line. Hope you don't mind me reaching out.
Oh, gosh. Of course I mind. So, yeah. You know, just cut the crap and why me?
Okay, so A, we'd all be better off if this entire sentence was deleted.
All right.
And B, answering this why me is missing right here, at least for the first couple lines. We can sort of skip down to the first, let's call it...
Yeah, spot on. They could start with the second line. So off we go.
Okay. So from here, I like how they're bringing in a similar company that they've helped. What's even better is they're at least building a list carefully, assuming they've collected a list of online communities. There's not millions of them online. There's a lot, but apparently they've at least had some thought into, okay, let's build a list of online communities to reach out to. This, I'm giving them thumbs up.
That's right. Street smarts for, you know, prospecting.
It makes it a whole lot easier to personalize this message if they are reaching out to several online communities, because this one email will be tailored to this industry at the very least. So I got a thumbs up there.
One quick remark, actually, is there's a theme of hoping in that email. The first one, the first line is like, hope you don't mind. The second one is, I was hoping. It's just like, you know, I'm not a big fan of hopes.
Right, but the tone they're going for here is very friendly, polite. I don't want to intrude. Hope you don't mind. They're really careful about sounding salesy here, but it may not be working to their benefit.
I think my guess is their last campaign landing on spam, and they're trying to please asking us not to click on that spam button.
Okay, let's see if we can churn out a couple more takeaways from this message. Now, their call to action is they're setting up an exploratory call. That in itself is totally fine, but there's something missing here, and I'm looking for a stat, something more concrete that I can understand. Maybe it's a number of hours per week saved, or it's a overhead cost reduced. I would love to see a concrete number that makes it obvious for me to understand why I'm going to look good if I engage with this brand.
Yeah, the interesting question that I have that we can't really answer from this email is like pretty much on a similar line as what you were saying, Jack, is that who has been contacted? Is it someone who is a manager in a certain factory, you know, close to, you know, using some product, or is it a CTO, or is it, you know, God knows who? And I think that's very important to figure out, you know, the understanding of the benefit associated, like cut the time. You know, cost associated with extracting the data, transforming it, and so on. Are we talking to a VA? Are we talking to the person doing the work? Are we talking to the person supervising the work?
Right.
Because they may have like different incentive or different benefits. So on top of that, what I'd love to see is like maybe a mini case study. Mm-hmm. So it's great that, you know, you're referencing the similar community that you're in. Like, I don't know personally Redbubble, so maybe I'm saying things that are factually incorrect, but I don't think this is an example of one of your customers. So if you were sending me this email, then I would hope like, hey, we're together in the same community. We've been helping computer X, or we've been helping someone else in this industry that we know, and then helping them doing what? Like cutting half their time to extracting the data or some stuff like that. And like we mentioned already on the show is, when you got like multiple benefits like that, don't put it all into one email, but actually cut them and add that into the follow-ups. The next follow-up could be like, hey, we've helping company X also extract data faster.
Yeah.
You know, is that a problem that you may also have? And then the next follow-up, you say, we've also been helping transforming XYZ, you know.
Break it down.
Yeah, break it down, mm-hmm. basically.
Let's go into editing mode here. The sentence that starts off, I would love to start a conversation with company. This is like a clear sign. If any of your cold emails start off with something along these lines, you know you're writing very selfishly. And as a copywriter, you've got to put your prospects first. Otherwise, it's going to be very easy to ignore and delete. So instead, think about how you can put the company first, or even better, that employee and their responsibilities first. Bringing in the concrete, like we had mentioned earlier, would be helpful. But it sort of spills into the call to action as well. Like, I'll read it one more time and then comment on it. The call to action is, what would your thoughts be on a purely exploratory call to determine if Aluma can add value? Keep in mind, Aluma is the company reaching out. Why would they phrase it such as, if Aluma can add value? Instead, it should be, if we can cut your overhead by 15%, or if we can save you $30,000 a year in computing costs, something like this. Easier to see, okay, I need to reply and follow up on this. Seeing if Aluma can add value, that's the bottom of the priority list for this prospect.
Yeah, I think you nailed it. It's so many things you touch about my own nuts. Like, obviously, this is an I type of email. The first line saying, I hope you don't mind, but they could have write it, I hope you don't mind. That would be the same thing. So it's very writer-centric. That's one thing. I like the, if we can be helpful. Again, there's no guarantee here. It looks like someone else did the prospecting. I'm not quite sure you're the correct person. So please help me out to figure out if the right person to contact. That's one more point. Like you mentioned, spot on, explore. Explore what? It'd be cool to explore a certain benefit that this person would have realized. And also, I'm not a big fan of the phrase again. You know, it's like when you say to someone, I would love something, it's like you're basically asking the other person for a favor, but I don't think you earned the right of anything at this stage. Mm-hmm. So really, you know, why would I help someone I didn't develop a relationship with? I mean, could work in different setups, but, you know, right. In business, it's very difficult. And the last thing I would say is they could have rephrased it slightly. Instead of saying, what would your thoughts be on a purely exploratory call to determine if blah, blah, blah can add value? I think they added purely exploratory in order to figure out, like, honestly, we're not going to try to sell you anything.
Yeah.
Well, then in this case, just say it into a different way. You could say something like, hey, can we have an exploratory call to see if benefit X will actually
apply
or be useful to you? And then you could say like, comma, you know, and then no string attached. That is better than just like trying to beg to some extent please trust me, you know, I make a favor to me. It's just like a terrible writing.
Yeah. We have a few notes for the follow-up email. It's quite short. A lot of similarities carry on with the follow-up. I'll take it from the top of the body. Hi, first name. Happy Friday. 2! Again, similar tone going on here.
My Friday was happy until I received this email, of course.
Okay, so the message continues. Thought you might be interested in this view of our real-time data stream. See below. Similar companies are utilizing Aluma to move their data into their data warehouse. Are you open to learning more about Aluma and our capabilities? I'll start off with a plus. I liked how they included more of a concrete benefit by, you know, just sharing a screenshot. If it really is groundbreaking or very helpful, this should nudge a few more prospects into hitting the reply button.
Yeah, so to like that too.
Okay. I'm ready to jump to the call to action. Did you have anything before then?
No, I really like that they're showing us something that they can do. It's way more concrete.
Mm-hmm. Sure. And for the call to action, similar advice. Instead of saying, are you open to learning more about Aluminar capabilities? Switch it on its head and figure out how to write that so that it's a clear benefit for the prospect's company. Are you open to hearing how company may be able to save 20% or something where I know it's going to make me look good if I hit reply and actually achieve this benefit they just mentioned?
Unless I'm working from Product Hunt, it's like, why would I need to learn about, you know, someone else's company capability? I got enough things on my plate. So probably not the most intelligent call to action. Recommendation for this company, just hire a better copywriter, honestly, at this stage.
Yeah, because it sounds like they've got a lot to offer. Just wording it in the right way should move the ball along.
Yeah, that's right. All right, that's it for today.
Okay, this was a bit of a basher, today's Teardown episodes. A lot to learn from and...
Come on, what do you mean? There was a lot of really good stuff going on. And I think there's definitely a lot of learnings in how to best approach some of the cold email, especially if you're trying to sell, you know, service, some of the right thing to do to differentiate your offering from any other cold email out there. I think if you apply some of those things we've just been discussing, then you'll see a lot more clients in your pipe and hopefully better clients as well.
Well, there you go. Okay. Jeremy, great cast, great Teardown.
Great cast, Jack. Thanks.
Hey, cold emailer.
Yeah, you.
If you got some value from this episode, give us a high five by sharing a 2-sentence review on iTunes.
Or Stitcher or TuneIn. That works too.
It's a quick way to help other growth-minded folks like us find this podcast.
So they can send awesome emails.
And make everyone's inbox a better place. Thanks.